Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all thoughts are open. To you, no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Righteousness and judgment for all who are oppressed.
It is well with you,
nor will he keep his anger forever.
He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our wickedness.
For as the heavens are high above the earth, so is his mercy great upon those who fear him.
As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our sins from us.
As the Father cares for his children, so does the Lord care for those who fear him. Second reading this morning is this Romans 14, 1 to 12. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some will even eat anything while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat. For God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall. And they all will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own words. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For this end, this is, and Christ died, and life lived again, so that he might be the Lord of both and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, every tongue shall give praise to me. So then each of us will be accountable to God. Word of the Lord.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ. Lord Christ.
Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii, seized him by the throat, saying, pay what you owe. And his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed. They went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So, my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. So, how did you like that last line? Feel comfortable? Anybody feeling a little uneasy? Well, it all began with a tree in a garden. Not Genesis, but another fascinating story out of my biography. When I was a little boy, Charleston was a little town. It was a town. It wasn't a city. It was a blade street. Across the street from my house was one of these double houses. So it's a house that was joined with another house. And a family lived one side, another family lived the other. There was a tunnel. Tunnel that kind of went straight through the building. And as you walk through it, it opens up into a garden, beautiful Charleston gardens. And in that garden was a tree, a crepe myrtle. And we thought that that would be a great place to play on. Well, we started climbing on the crepe myrtle and totally destroyed it. So my buddy lived on one side of the street of the house. This older couple lived on the other side. And, well, of course, we did what kids do when they do something wrong. Ran away. Hit
head for the hills. Absolutely. But you know, there's this kind of telepathic thing that mothers have. So when you get home, before we even practically got through the doorway, my mother knew what had happened. And she began to tell me that I was going to have to walk back across that street with my friend and apologize and say, I was sorry. See, I appreciate that now. I didn't necessarily appreciate it at the time. But what my mother was doing was trying to teach me to accept myself for all my flaws. Because I don't know if you guys have noticed it or not, but none of us are perfect. None of us are. And when we do something wrong, you say, well, I'm not perfect. You know, of course you aren't. None of us are. I mean, one of the great lessons in life is to learn that we are imperfect. And we're surrounded, guess what, by imperfect. How do we live in that world? How do we have relationships in that world? That was my mother's love. My mother's love was embedded in that lesson that she wanted me to learn. Guiding me to accept my mistakes, accept my flaws. Of course, it felt like punishment. It's the last thing I wanted to do. I'd rather, you know, run away or hide under a rock, or I was eyeing my buddy, figuring out a way I could get him to take the blame for it. Does any of this sound familiar? But what I felt was like punishment was really, in retrospect, love, because on the one hand, my mother was pointing out that I had done something wrong. But on the other hand, she was also saying, but our relationship is not over. You see? I've done something wrong. But I still love you. That's the greatest lesson we learn when we talk about forgiveness. Because not all children have that experience. Maybe I'm speaking to someone now who hasn't had that experience. Maybe you know people who haven't had that experience, or maybe you've experienced it throughout various pieces of your life. When you've been told, when you have done something wrong, that you're useless, that you're flawed, full stop, that you're a failure. And children absorb that, they feel that. And they'll live up to that. They'll carry it on into their lives. They'll struggle with it, and then they'll pass the curse on. We went up to the door. I told you it's like a tunnel, right? So don't get you in this tunnel. Knocking on the door, and they open the door, and they're both standing. Now, this was an older couple, right? And a bit scary to us. Not because they were scary people, they just didn't have much use for us, you know? They could have their own lives, they were kind of, and so we said, this is what we did, we're really, really sorry. And then they, you know, of course, told us, well, you know, that tree is really not very good for climbing. Something we had discovered ourselves, right? We already knew that pretty clearly. But, you know, sometimes it's a good thing to hear your sin articulated by somebody else. Sometimes it's a good thing to hear that from the mouth of somebody else and to stand there without excuse. That's a response, that attention. One of the things I discovered also on the layers of love, reflecting back on this, when I was a little kid, so looking back, because I still remember this so clearly, the color of the crepe myrtle in Solomon Garden. The this is what it meant. Love of neighbor. You know, and it's easy to love your neighbor if you like it. It's a little more difficult to love your neighbor if you don't like it. But it's a whole different thing to love your neighbor when you are the problem. And again, it's easier when you're the problem and your neighbor is your friend. But it's a whole lot harder when you're the problem and you have no idea whether you're going to be forgiven. That is hard. That takes acceptance of our flaws to a whole new level. Acceptance of our occasional carelessness and hurtfulness. That takes accepting, well, some rottenness, but still having hope. Hope as we stand there in that flawed condition. Hope of desire that's fueled by desiring something more, something better. That's why. And I can't stress this enough as I reflected on this issue of forgiveness this week. I can't stress this enough, that it takes faith to forgive. It takes faith to forgive. It takes faith because you have to believe that when you forgive, you're changing not only yourself and the other person, but the world. Because when you don't forgive, I can guarantee you're not going to heal. They're not going to heal. The world is going to be a worse place for you. That's just the facts. Potential to ask forgiveness, to receive forgiveness, to give forgiveness, is to make a better world, to become better people. I told you a story. Once I was my New Testament professor at seminary, Chris, when he was a young curate, he was British. He is British. And he was staying with a barrister. He was living with a barrister. And the barrister and he were having tea one day, and he said, "You know, Chris, you and I are sort of in the same business now. You see, when people come to us, they want us to kind of solve their problems. They want us to come with us. But with me, generally, they want to get off. They want to get out of trouble. But when they come to you, they want to do better." See, that is faith. That doing better is a powerful way to lead others. That's the slave's potential in this parable. To do better. He owes the master. It's an odd, sort of parable. You've got to get your head around the idea that the king is owed a debt, and the debt is some injury. Let's just call it an injury that this person has received from this other person, the slave. And it is an injury that is vast. We're talking about talents. We're talking about an unpayable debt. Like many of the things that we do to one another, they can't be repaid. We can't take back the word or the action. We can't take it back for anything. It's there. It's there. Once it goes out from us, there it is.
not, it can't be taken back. It can't be dismissed. It's a reality.
And the thing about the slave here, he knows this. Oh, he knows it. He knows that it is a terrible thing. Terrible, terrible thing. And he gets down on his knees and he begs to be forgiven. He begs to be forgiven. And out of mercy, incredibly important word, mercy. Out of mercy, the King, the Master, forgives. But it doesn't sink in. That's the lesson. That's the huge pivot in this parable. It doesn't sink into him. He doesn't feel it from the heart. What Jesus says at the very end, that we have to forgive from the heart, from the, when we talk psychological terms, from the ego, from the core of who we are. Maybe he thinks he's getting away with something, like I try to do when I was running across the street with my deed. Maybe he thinks he's in control, he's manipulated. Boy, I should pull one over on that guy. Maybe he feels like he's cleverly manipulating the situation. Clearly hasn't integrated forgiveness into his life. So when someone comes seeking forgiveness, and the denarii is a far lesser sum, just to say that. Far lesser injury that is asked for. He pushes their debt in their face. He humiliates them, which is about to say, you're worthless. You're useless. You might as well not live. Thinking back to that story again. Another form of love that I take from it is walking back across the street to my house, to my life. Do I walk across that street as a forgiven person? As a changed person? As someone who has had love penetrated into his heart, who I walk back across that street ready to pay forward what has been given to me? Well, probably not at that age. But as you can see, I still remember it. I think I remember it every time that I'm in that position. Perhaps the idea of faith is so that it becomes our default mechanism. When somebody has injured us, do we go to how can I forgive this? Can I move to a place where this is not the end of things, but perhaps the beginning? God, we should remember, is always the injured party in all of our injuries. God is always the one who is hurt. That's what the cross means. When Jesus is nailed to the cross, he takes all of our sins, and that means the sins that we already have done, the sins that we are doing, and the sins that we will assuredly do in the future. All of them. It's taken on his body and forgiven. Sin not be not to do a deal with Jesus. You know, as we used to say, you know, Jesus, I promise I'll go to church if you do this, this, and this. But to declare in your own heart that this is not a stopping place, that this is a starting place. That this flaw, this sin, is a new beginning, not an ending. Not an ending of a relationship, but the very beginning of a new kind of relationship. That can only happen face the sin itself. But there is a future. In forgiveness, you know, we often think, sort of psychologically, of course, we're all sort of post-Freudians, right? You know, we've got the internet to tell us about all that stuff, so. Very helpful. But we often think, oh, well, that, you know, to forgive somebody is for me to be relieved of this. But I don't have to spend my time worrying about this. This doesn't have to control it. And that's absolutely true. But to forgive also is to free another person. And to think about it this way is also that faith component. It's to free the entire world. To be a part of the redeeming work of the living and loving God. Not to let somebody off the hook. Not to say, well, it really doesn't matter. You know, not to forgive and forget. But to accept the reality of what has happened. Allow that to become the springboard into something new and unimaginable. And to believe that. That's where the faith comes from. So there's a missionary element in forgiveness. But the world itself can be changed by our forgiveness. This congregation, you guys, between yourselves, the world you walk in out there, the community we live in today, begins with us, not with them, not with those people, but with us. It percolates up because God has sent his Son down to us. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father,
worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us now pray for the Church and for the world.
Thank you.
we give you thanks and praise for this, your servant Jane, may you continue to grow in grace. Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, give grace this to your servant, Mary Ann, that you may continue to grow in grace. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, we give you thanks and praise for the union of this man and this woman, for the gift of love that you will bestow upon them. May it be nothing but deeper than the world. May it be the deeper than Christ's love in this world. In Jesus' name, we give you thanks and praise. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
1 year anniversary. Thanks and praise for the gift of community, the gift of this community. And we now invite all those who have news about what we're doing in this community, what the Holy Spirit is doing in this community, to offer them. So sit back and let's hear what God's doing in some of this. Jen.
Thank you. Others. Carr, and on behalf of the ECW, we will be having a meeting tomorrow evening at 7. And I apologize, it's advertised in our bulletin as being in Davis Hall. However, it will be virtual because it's getting darker, and some of us older ladies prefer not to drive in the dark and dusty roads in Cherokee County. So it will be virtual, so just dial in or whatever you do. And if you're not on my group list that you get an invite, email, call me. Call me, my phone. My phone number's in the bulletin, and I'll get you on our list to join us.
Okay, great. Yeah, I do encourage you to come to the forum. We've reached a point where we're talking about the Native American clearances, as we might say, Trail of Tears and that sort of thing, because we aren't in Cherokee County. And it had a great, I mean, if we talk about the history of the church, we cannot talk about it without talking about the Trail of Tears. This whole swath of Georgia became available on a larger scale to the settlement of our ancestors. So please come. And Corey is incredibly informative. I'm just there as a bobbing head for the meeting. But he's got a great background. Lord God, your Son made himself the least among us, bore our sins upon the cross, and delivered us from death by his own suffering and dying. Forgive us our sins, by which we have added to the world's pain, and make us instruments of peace and reconciliation, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us now confess our sins against God and against our neighbor. God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in everlasting life.
Amen.
Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Love as Christ loved us, and gave himself for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. hearts.
We lift up our cups to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right, and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, we praise you. Joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with blessed Mary, blessed Clement, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Christ has taught us, we are bold to say.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Would the lay person visitors come forward, please? On behalf of this congregation, I give you these holy gifts, that those to whom you may share, you go, may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. This is your part. We send you forth with the body and blood of Christ. We'll try that again.
We send you forth with the body and blood of Christ.
Savior Jesus Christ, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.